Hello, YouTubers. I'm Pruitt. This is Jim Davis. And today on WebDM, don't want to rattle any cages, wouldn't want to shed any bonds of friendship. Of course not. You'd want your diamonds back at that point. So, Indiana Jones, this one goes out to you.
Indy!
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 We named the dog Indiana. Well, Jim?
Snake people. What's not to like?
I mean, what is not to like?
What's more rock and metal than snake people?
Why did it have to be snakes?
First off, it's gotta be snakes because they're creepy.
They have means of motion, and it's magic.
It's magic, and it's magic. First
there's
off.
There's no legs, there's no wings.
And if it wasn't for that one that caused us all to sin, we'd be fine.
That's why.
That's that one snake. So snake people, right? It touches on everything we talked about in our Red Dragon show, right? About the reptilian, the cold-blooded eyes, except now they masquerade as humanoids, these snakes do.
How dare they?
They are the most, like, Conan villain that's in D&D, right? Like, they evoke all of these things about snake cults and people worshiping snakes or dancing with them, whether it's Greek goddesses thousands of years ago or people in Appalachia, right? It's just like the snake cult is like Pulp Fiction-y, sword and sandals, Dungeons and Dragons, and the Yonti deliver on that promise.
Exactly. Got snake charmers of, you know, in Desert Descent.
Right.
Right. Oh, but yeah, of course you have the, just an Appalachia.
I don't know where it is. I really don't. I hope there's nobody in. We have people in Appalachia. I love it. It's beautiful.
If you're in
country.
A snake cult, just please get out.
Just get out of the snake cult. But also, don't kill snakes that don't need to be killed. I have a problem killing snakes that don't need to be killed.
Well, that's an
issue. That's a personal failing.
Again, that's prejudice.
It is prejudice. You're damn right it's prejudice.
Yeah.
I prefer limbs to slithering. And so with snake people, there's just a creepiness to it. And the fact that they are these former human civilization that through sorcery and just the will to power kind of turned themselves into snakes, divested themselves of their emotion, gave themselves over to these serpent deities, and were sort of the first human civilization, if you're going by the sort of loose lore of Dungeons and Dragons, to achieve sorcery, complex metalworking, a trade system that allowed them to dominate the other civilizations of their time. And then, of course, that's what brought them low and eventually caused their downfall, and now they sort of survive in the shadows.
Yeah.
That's what I like about the Yonti. And so there's a ton of things you can do with them. You can go with the default backstory and say, yes, they live in, you know, these ancient cities in the deep jungle or the remote hills, that kind of thing. Or you can just take the fact that they're snake people and then make them the head of some sort of weird snake fertility cult that operates out of the capital in these sort of decadent opium dens and sort of like these crazed sex parties that they have where they're roping in all these people, and then the upper layer of that is just sort of your typical orgy, right? You know,
well,
you
gotta
throw that at the players.
You gotta
know what that's like, right?
Right. We've all had to say no to a sex orgy cult.
Eventually, you've just had enough.
But I love that the idea you want to rope in all the wayward kids on the street. You know, I mean, you know, you got kids coming of age. They don't have any whatever. Yeah. Hey, come over here. We can have some sex.
You can have this. We got this for you. There's a nice place you can be. We'll accept you. And then the next level's the creepy eyes wide shut mask.
Yeah, you got to wear a mask and some robes.
Right. And then eventually they're throwing all these people into a giant snake pit full of D&D sized snakes down at the bottom of this chasm where making more of themselves. And so there's this sort of weird inverted pyramid of it. And so that's what you can do with the Yonti as a villain in your group. In my mind, the Dungeons and Dragons world is a little too clean and crisp for me. And I think that's a product of the fact that in the 80s there was all these rumors of Satanism, and then that whole thing in second edition D&D where the articles like good must always triumph and law enforcement always has to be abiding and no drug use, no sex, no graphic violence. I'm like, this D&D. Yeah. Like, you took out all the fun parts of it.
Yeah. Now, here's the thing about that censorship, though, is it does breed an extreme reaction, which is probably why we got the Book of Erotic Fantasy.
Well, the Book of Erotic Fantasy is one. I mean, I happen to think the Book of Erotic Fantasy is a fun book. It's not as bad. It's not as bad as Fatal. Fatal is the anal circumference RPG, but the Book of Erotic Fantasy isn't the worst book that was put out for third edition.
Yeah.
Not by far. Anyway, so I think that there's the D&D world is a lot dirtier and messier and gray than I think the D&D worlds that come out of TSR and sort of kind of continued by Wizards of the Coast, even though they did bring back demons, devils, things like that.
Yeah.
So I think like in a typical D&D world, there's probably snake cults everywhere because you look at the monster manual, how many monsters in there are serpentine. There's all the dragons, there's Dahir, there's basilisks, there's Medusa and Hydra. Mm-hmm. Like all of these things that have serpent features. And if you figure that in these worlds, there's got to be people who just look at a dragon and go, that's good enough for me.
Yeah.
Like, I'll just worship this thing.
Well, that there's a physical manifestation of a power beyond your scope and grasp.
Right there. And so I think that serpent cults would be a part of that, and they might be just everywhere. Of course, you're gonna have.
Sorry to go back to that point, but you're gonna have your principal vaginas that are gonna go. I'm gonna go and pray to the thing that's literally breathing fire in the sky.
Literally breathing fire, controlling the weather. So I think that now, just imagining a giant dragon that shows up. Show me what you got. It's just like shit.
I want to eat what you got.
I want to eat what you got. So I think that the Yanti, this is how I would use them in a campaign. They're an urban snake cult, and I would rewatch that scene in Conan the Barbarian where they're sneaking into the temple, and there's nothing down there, just a giant snake that these people worship as a god. And use it like that, or would have sort of a jungle setting. I'm remembering the campaign that we did where it all took place in Chult, sort of the jungle peninsula in the far south of the Forgotten Realms.
Mm-hmm.
And it's dinosaurs and lizard people and just jungle shenanigans. And if you're going to play in a game like that, then why isn't there a great big city of the Yonti, and perhaps they're in a three-way war with the Kwadl and the Naga.
Mm.
And so there's this sort of, okay, the two evil factions are fighting against each other, but there's a sort of a good aligned serpent faction that's there as well. I can see something like that forming the basis of a campaign or a jaunt. You know, you're tired of the urban adventuring that you're doing, send your players on a ship to steamy Chult and have them get involved in a lot of serpent shenanigans there.
Come try our Chulten nights.
Yes.
It's hotter than a snake's ass.
It is hotter. So they do have a rivalry with Naga, even though they're both serpentine. You can ignore that if you want, and it's just like throw all the snake monsters in there into your Yonti cult. Volo's Guide really expands the options available to Yonti, and you can really have a wide range of monsters and in terms of abilities, their ability to influence the campaign outside of combat, of course, creating memorable combat encounters. Yeah. So in that respect, Volo's really delivers on expanding those options for using the Yonti in your campaign.
Let's briefly just touch on those different types.
So Yonti sort of exist in this hierarchical society. They're all sort of a mix of humanoid and serpent. So looking at the monster manual, the ones that are presented there, the Abomination is this sort of snake-headed human torso with a giant sort of snake lower body that kind of leads cults or organizations of Yonti. And that's kind of the pinnacle, seen as the pinnacle of Yonti-dom, Yonti-hood. They've got a lot of different immunities and defenses that make them a versatile opponent.
Right.
Obviously, you wouldn't want to encounter them alone. That just sort of goes without saying with almost every 5th edition monster. You want to include them in some kind of group. The Malisons are sort of the next group, and depending on what arrangement of snake to human parts they have, they have different abilities. So you have some that have they have a human body but a snake head.
Yeah.
And others are a human upper body but a snake lower body. Or then the ones that are the weirdest to me are the ones that are just a human with just snake arms, which I feel is like utterly inconvenient for those Yonti. Like if you woke up and that was the kind of Yonti you'd become, you'd be like, I can't do anything with snake arms, guys.
Can you eat with your hands?
Maybe my hands can just eat over here. Mm-hmm. I don't know. That kind of seems like a raw deal for those. It'd be like, I can't be the ones that get like a snake lower body and slither around.
No. Yeah, yeah. No, he's just hungry all the time, and he's always got his hands in his pockets.
He's always got his hands in his pockets.
People think wrong of him, but he's just eating down there.
He's just eating.
But he's just like,
He's just there. And then, of course, there are the purebloods, which are mostly human, but have serpentine features. Fangs, forked tongue, serpent's eyes.
The Asimar tieflings
of snakedom. So, you know, those are going to be your spies, possibly your diplomats, things like that. Now, looking at Volos, which greatly expands on the options available to Yonti, both in terms of the chapter that really goes into the breakdown of like their gods that they have and what a typical city looks like, helps you role play out the Yonti. Then also the varieties that they have in like the actual monster section. We've got the Anathema. Yeah. This is the sort of multi-headed snake creature thing. It looks like a cross between a Hydra and a Medusa and a snake creature to me. They view themselves as demigods, semi-divine, and have the stats kind of to back it up for a mid-level party. Mm-hmm. So probably between like 8th and 10th level, one of these with obviously other types of Yonti to back it up could make a really memorable encounter. Maybe you're fighting on like a stone bridge over the breeding pits that they have, and there's your cliff that you need.
You need
there's
a cliff. You
can to knock people off of.
You can push people 15 feet and make it matter.
Maybe it's like three bridges across the thing, so there's some lateral movement that can be used, and doesn't create just one choke point for the encounter. That'd be something that I might consider for it. Or maybe it's like the Anathema's there on a sacrificial altar, and they're busy pulling out the still beating hearts of whatever before they throw the body to the dire snakes that are going to eat it. There's the Brood Guard, which is sort of a captured human that's turned into a snake humanoid creature monster thing. Yeah. They're sort of the grunts. Yeah, throw a bunch of them out there.
Yeah. For the Palace Guards.
And then they offer us three warlocks based on the three main serpent deities. These are going to be the Mind Whisperer, the Nightmare Speaker, and the Pit Master. And they correspond to each of the three different types of Malisons. So Mind Whisperers have sort of a snake head. It's implied that they sort of sneak into, you know, the civilized world and establish cults, sort of try to influence rulers and things like that. This is one of those areas where I think it's perfectly fine for DMs to go, the stats that a monster has are for combat. And then what I need it to do outside of combat, it just does. Yeah. Right? So if you look at the stats in Volos, it doesn't suggest, I mean, it's got like Charm Person, Crown of Madness, some other sort of like mind-influencing spells, but it doesn't suggest like center of a vast conspiracy of snake worshippers sort of thing. So I might give a Mind Whisperer or Nightmare Speaker or any of the others, just say like for campaign purposes, it's got these other abilities. Now when you face it in combat, this is what it can bring to bear.
Right.
But I don't think DM should feel like constrained because they look down at the monster stat block and goes, well, it really doesn't have that much in the way of being able to influence people magically.
Yeah.
If you need it to, you should just have it.
Well, but like Barry said, influence is a weed.
Right.
You must tend yours.
You must tend yours.
Let it grow.
Absolutely. So, and then the next one, the Nightmare Speaker, these are warlocks that are dedicated to sort of the night serpent, the destruction of the world. This is the serpent in the D&D world.
It's going
to eat the world, that kind of thing. They love to torture others, not necessarily kill them. And then there are the Pit Masters, who are the ones that have these sort of masses of snakes for arms. Really cool picture in Volos, actually.
Yeah.
And they are the ones that kind of tend the brood, sort of keep everything copacetic, traditionalists, as it were. But all three of them are going to be found in one of these temple cities or underground cults.
Yeah, but that pit master is going to be down there just whipping away.
Keeping
that sexual tension up.
Yes, there's so much.
Do you think in a snake cult there's just at least one pit always going?
There must be, right? Like, I mean, and
it's like crops, you just kind of rotate your pits.
You just kind of rotate them. I mean, there's a weird connection between snakes and fertility, I think, both in our own history. And I think DMs would do well to, like, look at real-world snake worshiping and just wiki it. Yeah. And just, like, try to figure out ways to incorporate some of that real-world color into their D&D campaigns, and that's the kind of research that you need to do as a DM in order to really make campaigns memorable. It's one of the reasons why I love DMing is that most of the time when you're prepping for a game, it's just thinking like, all right, how am I going to use this? What's weird ways I can do that? Is there anything creepy I can do with it? Is there any way I can subvert player expectations?
Jim, you loved G.I. Joe, right?
I loved G.I. Joe. I mean, I was a kid in the 80s, right? Like, how could you not love G.I. Joe?
Yeah.
Are we talking about...
Well, in general...
What I think we're talking about?
Well, one specific. Okay. But in general, the whole idea of a snake cult.
The whole idea, like, first off.
A different way of thinking about the snake cult. I mean, yeah, we talk about, you know, it's sex, whatever. You could do it that way. But right. Another way to think about it... I mean, you got Cobra Command there.
And we got Cobra Commander.
Who's just bent on, like... ruling the world, like right. A different way to think about it.
Right. So I think that one of the things I like about the Vianti is this whole idea that there are reptilian humanoids, lizard folk, Yonti, probably a couple others that are bullywugs, maybe, amphibious. Reptiles and amphibians, and then all the mammals.
Yeah.
Right. And so, yeah. Like, maybe there's this tension between those reptilian and amphibian humanoids and the mammalian humanoids.
The hot bloods.
The hot bloods that boils over. And maybe that's like a central or mm-hmm. one of the driving tensions in your campaign. Sort of mm-hmm. like, yeah, those lizard people and snake people, they like might have been the first, but they've been deposed and, you know, they're... cities long buried under the oceans and beneath mm-hmm. the ice. And, well, they're kind of upset about that.
Yeah.
Seeking to regain that. I would use G.I. Joe. I know that the G.I. Joe animated movie is, like, for G.I. Joe purists, might not be the most faithful. I don't know. There's, like, all fandom. As soon as you walk into it, there's going to be people who get upset yeah. about what you have to say. But
and,
I love...
And nostalgia is a strong...
Nostalgia is a strong thing. And so yeah. I think the city... of serpent people that they're trying to spore, you know, seed the world with their spores and mm-hmm. the, whatever, the Nemesis Enforcer and then the yeah. other one.
Gallibulus?
Gallibulus. I always get it confused with the Roman sun god.
That's
what I just do.
And who wouldn't make that mistake?
Who wouldn't make that mistake?
I mean, especially if you have a master's degree.
Especially. Gullibulus, Elagabal. Same difference. It's the imagery is there, and I like the idea of a forgotten civilization that is trying to reclaim mm-hmm. some of its former glory through subversive organizations, spy cults, there's all kinds of different things. And in that respect, I love G.I. Joe, and I would use Cobra as the basis for a Yonti organization.
And D&D's made it easier to have a G.I. Joe-esque fight where nobody really dies.
Nobody really dies.
You take people down, they make their death saves, get dragged off, you see them again.
You see them again.
But you destroyed their stuff.
Uh-huh, yeah.
That's because that's all it's about.
And 5th edition does have that going for it. If you want a long-running campaign where, you know, a villain is recurring or...
It's the Marvel way also. It's comic books also.
Now, that doesn't always track to me with how players play because I find that no matter what group I'm playing with, players are bloodthirsty and relentless in letting opponents get away. So that might be one of those things that if you want to run that kind of game, then you might want to just talk to your players and be like, hey, I'd like some reoccurring villains here. They will get away.
Other than G.I. Joe and sex cults, what?
You were asking if there was more on my mind?
Yeah. Yeah. How would you go about this?
I mean, I think the other ways to use them are taking that idea that that because they're a fallen civilization, they are trying to undermine and influence the different governments of the world. So let's take Forgotten Realms here for a minute. There's the Serpent Hills where the Yonti are active, and there's probably going to be Chult where they're there. But how are they going to infiltrate Waterdeep?
Yeah.
Is there more than one way? Yes, they can do this sort of weird fertility thing, and they're going to attract some people to that because they're freaky and weird and like that. But how are they going to get in with the masked lords of Waterdeep? Mm-hmm. How are they going to infiltrate those things to learn about them? So, I mean, this is just kind of one of those things about a typical D&D world that just must be going on all the time. Yeah. Is are there doppelgangers there? Are there shape-shifted purebloods? You know, do they have a base of operations somewhere in the sewers where they kind of can reconnect before going off to the more remote wilderness where their actual temple city is. Mm-hmm. And that's sort of a three-arc campaign. There's uncovering the corruption in the court, mm-hmm. finding the snake cultists who are there. Which of the six snake cults in the city is the one that's actually behind this? Right. Maybe those other five are planted by the initial one as decoys.
Yeah.
And they're harmless. They just are like snakes.
Yeah.
And so I that's kind of how we do it. So the first part of that campaign might be uncovering which one's the real cult, which one's the real threat. Okay, what's the extent of their influence? Can we thwart it somehow? All right, now we're going to take out their base of operations in the city. That leads us to their larger one out there, where it's like, oh crap, they've been breeding snake monstrosities in there for forever, and they were going to use that to sort of overthrow this one city.
It's going to take us a month just to get out there.
It's going to take a month just to get out there, and then when you're out there, you're on their home turf. And so that's like a good 3 or 4 months worth of gaming.
Yeah.
Just framing it like that, and you can make sure that there's more than just, you know, these 8 or 9 monsters that they're constantly fighting by varying it up. The cult has allies. The Yonti have cultivated other humans to sort of like bringing them into the fold. So there's bandits and bandit captains that they're having to deal with. There are legitimate cultists who are like, yes, this is my religion. This is my thing. You can't do this. They have no, and they're just like, you know, they just are who they are. They're not necessarily Yonti.
Right.
Maybe there's allied wizards or something that they're trading information in term in exchange for cooperation. Because if these are the first spellcasters amongst humans, then the magic they have must be phenomenal. So they can trade that information with mortal spellcasters. Those are all the different ways that I would have it. So I'd go through the monster manual. What's every snake-themed monster I can find? And just slightly reskinning them, those are the kinds of things that the party's going to have to deal with. Yes, skin that snake. That's not a sexual reference. This is a weird episode as well. It's kind of an odd day.
Well, it's all right. We have to get there
eventually.
Right.
Hopefully our viewers will forgive us. So that's how I would structure a campaign based on that. If it's the one where you want to feature the jungle and it's sort of like Quaddle and Naga and Yonti, then you create kind of a sandbox situation. Maybe they're outposts of the Yonti. And you have to sort of whittle away at them until you can isolate them in their one city. And, you know, do you ally with the Naga, who are no joke, you know, they've got some power behind them, or do you ally with the Quaddle and sort of use that to rid the jungle of its evil influence and all these snakes everywhere?
Fucking snakes.
Yeah, so that's sort of that's kind of what I'm talking about when I say, like, you should create an organization. That organization should have goals. The organization is an antagonist to the party, but there should be other organizations that are free-floating that could be, you know, used to oppose the party if the primary antagonists align themselves with them, or that the party can approach and say, hey, we need your help. And that's how you create a structure to your campaign. And the beauty of doing that is that you don't need to have an overall plot.
Right.
It can just be, yeah, this is what the snake cult of Yonti wants to do.
These are their goals. Now there's a conflict.
And the players get involved, and eventually it kind of runs on its own.
Yeah.
That's sort of an example of how I would do that with specifically with this monster.
Well, I mean,
there you go.
There you go. What more do you need?
Snake people.
I don't know. I don't like it. I don't like it one bit.
No, sir, I don't like it.
Deodorant's failing me today. That's weird.
Yeah.
Oh, wait. That's why.
You're all sweaty.
This pillow's all hot.
Yeah.
I'm going to try to do this one without it. I got back sweat.
Sweaty man back.
We're the sweaty man backs.
There's so many sweaty man backs. I've forgotten what it's like to be at a show.
Oh,
It's been like 6 years since it was a Decemberist show.
Yeah, no,
it was that one where everybody spread out.
No,
and just chilling.
It's like every person has a full 5 foot square. Like they take up. So you have good 5 feet on each side of you. Nobody's near you. You just easily navigate the crowd. But no, this is a fucking rock show.
Right.
Because I mentioned that to Corey. It's the one thing you get at a rock show where you're sitting there, and people are slipping by, and you get that full body rub.
Uh-huh.
Their full back is all against your full front, and you just have to accept it as part of the social contract of going to the rock show. That hey, guess what? I'm gonna rub my front on your back. Like buttering one piece of toast with another piece of toast.
Yep. just what it's like.
And hey, and the rock's dropping, you know? And so, anyway. Ugh,
buttery so man backs. All right.
Let's put some butter between us and just let me slip up here to the mosh pit.
Oh, God.
Yeah.